everybody. Thanks for coming here tonight. My name is Rachel Verveldi. I'm Congressman Grothman's Chief of Staff. Glad to see all of you. We're glad to have you. I want to run through with you real quick how we do our town halls. The Congressman will give you an update on what's going on in Congress and the things that he's been working on. After we do that update, we will be doing questions. So the way our questions work is you should have filled out a piece of paper when you came in and stuck it into our bucket. Those questions will be randomly drawn from the bucket by me, and I'll call your name. When I call your name, you can feel free to stand, sit, whatever you're comfortable with, and ask your question of the Congressman. Once you ask your question, he will respond, and we'll just keep on going through the bucket. Just a reminder to everyone to remember not to clap or speak over anyone when they're talking, including all of you.
Every time I got to think of something new, so that everyone can watch the exact same presentation.
Thank you for coming today. And our flag is over here. Everyone can stand up, and we'll do the pledge of allegiance.
You going to be here tomorrow? You going to be here tomorrow?
Yeah.
I got to think of something new.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And here's Congressman Grothman for you.
Hi. Well, like Rachel said, we're going to talk a little bit about what's been going on in Washington, maybe say some things to you in the paper, and then we'll open it up for questions. I think the one thing that's on most people's mind is last week we passed the omnibus bill. You could argue the omnibus bill is the most important bill for a year. The omnibus bill contains all of the funding for the current fiscal year. And something that shows that there's something wrong with Washington is for the fiscal year that begins October 1st, 2017. Okay, so we're already 6 months into the year. It contains just what we call discretionary spending. Discretionary spending is about 30% of the total federal budget. Historically, the discretionary spending on a federal level is about one-half military, one-half non-military spending. I voted against the bill just right off the top because there was too much spending. Well, first of all, I digress. It is ridiculous, of course, to vote on this year's budget one-half of the way through the year. Until this point, we operated on continuing resolutions, most of which I vote for, which just keeps the government open, spending the exact same amount as the prior year. And I would have been fine to keep voting for that sort of thing. The other thing about the bill is a little bit ridiculous. It was over 2,000 pages. We did not get a copy of that bill until less than 24 hours before we voted on it. Even when we get a copy of the bill, it's not something the average person would understand. It's a copy of legalese. So in other words, they make a reference to section 297, parent B, parent H, which unless you look that up, you don't necessarily know what that means. So in any event, all we had to go on was kind of summaries provided by leadership. We did not actually delve into the bill. And even today, earlier ones like this, people sometimes come up and ask me about something in the bill that I am not aware of it because I wasn't focusing on that individual provision. And of course, I don't know at length what's in the bill. What I didn't like about the bill overall is we're in a position here in which we are about $21 trillion in debt. In the current year, it looks like we'll be borrowing about 21% of our budget, which is just on the face of it preposterous. This bill contained about a 10.5% increase in military spending and about a 9.5% increase in non-military spending. Donald Trump had originally proposed about a 5.5% increase in military spending and about a 6 or 7% cut in non-military spending. Donald Trump originally wanted this year to be flat compared to last year, but Congress wouldn't go along with that. One of the things that makes this bill difficult to put through Congress is unlike most elected bodies. In the U.S. Senate, when it comes to spending bills, they require 60 out of 100 senators to vote for it, which means you need both Republicans and Democrats. I enjoy working with the Democrats, but that obviously makes it much more difficult than just getting 51 votes. I think as a practical matter, what happened there is some members of the Armed Service Committee told Paul Ryan they were going to be a real problem for him unless they got a 10.5% increase. And I think the Democrats told them, I'm thinking, that the only way we're going to give you a 10.5% increase in military spending is to give you a 9.5% increase in non-military spending, which is kind of the opposite of what you think. One goes up more, you shouldn't send the other one up more. But that's what happened, which is why we have such a high spending bill. And quite frankly, it does, together with previous funding for damage caused by the hurricanes, caused this to be the biggest increase in discretionary spending on a federal level since George Bush's final year. Or we call it George Bush's final year. They passed this big stimulus package, which resulted in an even bigger increase than this. People who are in favor of a big increase in military spending will tell you, this is true, that we are still not back military spending to where we were in, I think, 2010 or 2011. They feel we have to get back there. I don't think they had to go up this quick. And on the face of it, it's a little bit ridiculous, because you got to remember, for the first 6 months of this year, operating on continuing resolutions, we're spending the exact same amount as we did last year. So if you're giving an agency, let's say, an 8% bump, that's an 8% bump that they don't have to spend it all. They put something in there, they can carry it forward. But nevertheless, it's an 8% annual bump that you would, you're saying, is necessary for the final 6 months of the year. Well, that's a lot of money for these agencies to swallow, including the Department of Defense. I had called Donald Trump's office. It's not like I called Donald Trump and he called over and says, Glenn Grothman wants to talk to you. But at least I called his office last week. I wanted him to be there. I think if he would have been there, he could have, you know, made it a little bit more fiscally responsible. Maybe kept 1 or 2% off of it. I did talk to the Democrat leadership, Nancy Pelosi and Stan Hoyer, in the House, and they both implied they would have been okay with a 2% cut in non-military spending. They would have got a 2% cut in military spending. So I think that's something Donald Trump would have been able to get. It would have caused a little bit of chaos, and the government would have shut down on Friday night if we didn't pass anything. But I really think you could have brought back enough congressmen to vote to continue with the continuing resolution on Monday morning or Tuesday morning. Would have been a little bit chaotic, because sometimes congressmen go on trips abroad and that sort of thing. But I think we would have got enough work done. Within a couple of weeks, we could have made something a little bit more fiscally responsible. Nevertheless, this is what I'm hoping dealt with. Look on the bright side, if there is a bright side. I think Donald Trump, being a new president, is still learning a little bit. It's obvious that he was kind of mad that he got this put on his desk. Just as we were mad, he got put on the desk. I think his administration was also a little bit unaware of everything that was in the bill. He said he won't let something like this happen again, which is a step in the right direction. Maybe it will cause him to be a little bit more aggressive in keeping spending underlying in the future. From a parochial perspective, I have wanted welfare reform very much. The current welfare system discourages work, discourages people forming families. In order to change that, we're going to need Donald Trump to use all of his political chits to drive something through Congress. And hopefully the fact that he's a little bit mad at this level of overspending will make him a little bit more aggressive in driving welfare reform for the rest of this year. If he doesn't get it done this year, a little bit more regressive, a little bit more aggressive in doing something the beginning of next year. So that's what's going on. I will say, in order to get welfare reform done, Congress can do that with 51 votes in the Senate. In order to do that, they have to go through a process called reconciliation, which both houses agree. Both houses agree that we will use our one chance to do something with 51 votes in the U.S. Senate for 2018 on welfare reform. I've talked to some of the senators that think it's going to be a difficult thing to get through the Senate, even to name that is what they want to do in 2018. And pardon me, because there are only 21 Republicans in the Senate, so you have, there are 51, so you'd have to get 50 of the 51 on board. And of course, you can park right now, John McCain is very ill. He may not even be able to vote on something like that, which makes it more difficult. But I think if Donald Trump would really make it a priority, he would have a chance to get something done. I think on welfare, the three things they'd be looking at are drug testing, time limits on some welfare programs, and work requirements. So that's a little bit about the budget. The next thing I'll talk about, I had some offs that were since then, but I'll go through one more time, the tax cuts. We were in a meeting here a little while ago, and we were informed, I don't know if he was going to go public with this, so even I'm sure their numbers will be reformed by LTC here, that their average employee was, I believe they told me, saving about $140 because of the tax cuts. I would think that's making par for the course for, you know, an average employer, which I think is a significant thing. The major goal of the tax cuts is to cause the economy to grow. Some people say, how can you cut taxes and expect to balance the budget? But really, our goal has to be to get back to the days where the American economy is growing by 4 or 5% a year. Our corporate income tax rate is completely uncompetitive with other countries. Even Barack Obama pointed out that we had a problem with the top corporate rate. So we lowered the top corporate rate from 35% to 21%. There was a feeling that if we were going to lower the corporate rate, we had to do something with the individual rate as well. Not only so the small businesses could be competitive with the big corporations, but to be fair to everyone else. Insofar as I weighed in on the bill, I weighed in strongly to what I think make things more favorable to the average person. The original Republican plan was to treat investment income at one-half the income that you earn as a working person. I do not think that was right. I do not think you can justify if somebody inherits a bunch of money as living off interest income, they pay half the tax of somebody who's working. So we chipped away and changed that. I also weighed in particularly strongly on the medical deduction. I used to do taxes, and I think people who use the medical deduction are usually people are going through a tough time in their life. Some Republicans wanted to take that out because they wanted to simplify taxes, and they said relatively few people use the medical deduction, so let's just get rid of that line. To me, when I think of the medical deduction, I think of people in nursing homes. I think increasingly over time, people with big health insurance premiums. I think of people with big deductibles going through their 401ks. I think, you know, that's just a deduction we have to leave in there. I was disappointed that we didn't get rid of more what I'll call corporate loopholes. There's something called carried interest that I tried very hard to get out of there. It's a special tax break in which hedge fund managers who are get capital gain treatment on something that should be ordinary income treatment. It's nothing a lot of people are familiar with, but quite frankly, it defines special tax treatment for the ultra-rich. They made mild changes in it, but only mild changes. They didn't really do what they should do. I had an individual bill that I tried to introduce to try to kind of embarrass Congress to next time they look at this tax bill, getting rid of that special tax treatment. I don't know what else to be successful or not, but I think if you had a public debate between people who wanted to have hedge fund managers receive ordinary income treatment for their gains, people want to receive capital gain treatment, I think the people on my side of the issue would win that debate. So hopefully my bill will go somewhere and we can embarrass Congress into getting that one right the next time we look at it. As far as other things that are going on, obviously we had the horrific shooting in Florida a little over a month ago now. There are two ways that I will weigh in on this, and I'm sure many different congressmen will introduce many different bills. One thing I would like to do is I have a bill that I think I have a chance to become law in a larger education package. The federal government right now sends money to local school districts and states for education, allowing more flexibility for that to be used to make schools safer. You know, things like metal detectors, that sort of thing, training for the Department of Public Instruction, training to local school districts on how to make their schools become safer. I think that given the school safety is so much more important today even in 10 years, so I think that's a good thing. The other thing I'm going to do is one of the problems in the Florida shooting was that the local governments down there, both the sheriff and school districts, took pride in not charging people with crimes. Tell everybody how wonderful this is. Wish I had a few more people here today, so we go back home and say, wow, I missed a job in this office hours tomorrow. In any event, they were almost boasting the degree to which they had many less people charged with crime in Broward County last year compared to a couple of years ago. They had reduced the amount of charges filed against young people by, it was either 70 or 75%. Not because the number of crimes went down, there's just this theory out there that we are harming young people by charging them with crimes because it makes them more unemployable in the future. Well, the reason we charge people with crimes is, first of all, sometimes to take them off the street, and secondly, to get them into a system in which hopefully they become rehabilitated. Nicholas Cruz had police have been called on him over 30 times, and if you read about him, he did all sorts of horrific things. He could have been charged with crimes. You could argue that he should have been in prison or in jail, and even if he wasn't in prison or jail, if he would have been convicted of some of these things, it would have been illegal for him to own these weapons. So a lot of what happened down there was the local government's trying to call. Now, that's a local control thing. If local people want to hire a sheriff or elect a district attorney who with pride says, I'm not going to charge people with crimes, then it's a foolish thing for them to do, but they can do it. What I didn't like is that the prior Secretary of Education, with pride, was trying to push local units of government down this path of not charging young people with crimes. And there are things we can do to reduce our prison population. But the idea of reducing our prison population by not charging dangerous people with crimes is not the way to go. And we've got to kind of, I think, nip that policy in the bud. We should stop any future Secretaries of Education from issuing guidance that is discouraging local units of government charging people with crimes. I have also asked Betsy DeVos to lift that guidance right now, and I hope we will be successful with that. Betsy DeVos is the current education secretary, appointed by Donald Trump. Next thing to look at, I am on the education committee. We are looking at higher education. My goal there, when we pass the higher education bill, is to make sure more students are getting jobs with their higher education degrees. Kind of appropriate to be here in my appropriate to be here in a technical school, because I do think right now some of the people who are getting a school in a traditional four-year college would be better off going to technical school. I mean, if you talk to the manufacturers around here, I was talking to one of the trade schools up there, the pipe fitters, a couple days ago up there in Kaukauna. They are looking for good people. I mean, a lot of the people doing the skilled jobs in this country are older, they're going to retire, and if we're going to continue to be a top five manufacturing state, we're going to continue to have people build the roads, build the buildings of the state, we're going to need a lot more people in these trades, skills to man our factories. A lot of these people are making more money, sometimes a lot more money, than people getting a traditional four-year degree or a traditional master's degree. And our higher ed in the future is going to try to push educational institutions into making sure people get degrees in which they have jobs. They're going to do that in part if the law, if the bill ever becomes law, in sanctioning schools that have a significant number of their students who are unable to pay their student loans. If an educational institution has people who are not being able to pay their loans, it means they're failing, right? I mean, if you're an educational institution, you ought to be thinking of looking out for the best interest of your students. If that student is taking a $20,000 or $50,000 loan and not repaying it, you have failed as an educational institution. And ultimately, some of those educational institutions should no longer be eligible for future student loans. So that's one of the goals that we have there, and I'm trying to see what I can do to see if we get those things done on the floor of the House of Representatives, but on the floor of the U.S. Senate as well. What else do we have here? We voted as part of the budget, or part of a budget that I voted for, more money to combat opioid abuse and other drug abuse. We've got more money available for inspections at the borders, or the fentanyl coming in from China. It's just a horrible thing. We also are sending money in to local governments, both to encourage more treatment and more drug drug task forces for local law enforcement. Hopefully that'll move the ball in the right direction. One other thing I'm looking to do insofar as we task for future programs with regard to opioid abuse is pay the local treatment facilities based on results, not just on doing something in the passage, but too many treatment facilities that are not necessarily successful. And I think you pay people by saying this person is drug free for 6 months or 1 year or 2 years. You wind up getting a better result rather than somebody that to facilities that may not be doing that good of a job. So that's what's going on. Opioid abuse. What else do we want to talk about here? School safety. I guess that's really it for now. We'll open up for questions and we'll see what you guys want to know. What else do you guys want to hear about?
Chris, Jenny?
Yes.
Would you like to ask a question?
No.
William Wirch?
No questions, thank you.
Yeah. James Krieger? No James? Roy Sheehan?
Yes. Oh. Yes, I have a question. Sure. It's pretty difficult for me to follow the news recently. Okay. So many of the things you cover are things that I am interested in. I understand that schools have now of legislation was passed for safety in the schools from possibly an outside shooter.
Isn't there some sort of program the state has something?
To allow more funding, yeah.
Right.
But there was on a federal level.
There was more funding in the office as well.
Okay. So there was. So in light of all of this, simply stated, what about shootings in churches like down in Texas? What about shootings down in Vegas along the strip at a public concert, that's the right word to use, I believe. What about shootings in Colorado in a theater? Okay. Anything on that?
Well, I think we did pass, or we didn't, I don't think it's law yet, but we passed out of the House a bill designed for more coordination on background checks between state and federal government. That may have some influence. We are putting more money into mental health treatment. I suppose you could argue that anybody who kills this many people needs some mental health treatment. I think over time that may be an improvement as well.
Okay. Bump stock?
I wouldn't be surprised if bump stocks are made illegal. That hasn't been done yet.
I would be pleasantly surprised. 30 magazine clips?
That's a debate that we can
have. Yes, it is a debate. Okay. So, you know, all of these things can be done. I am a gun hunter. I'm an avid hunter. Do not think I am not. But if I need a 30-round clip to drop a deer, I certainly, or anybody does, I certainly don't want to be your meat processor.
Okay, thank you.
Michael Harlanich? Michael? No question. Karen Sullivan?
I have some questions, but they may have been addressed as far as the gun safety and what we are willing to propose and follow through with, because strongly about us listening to these students, and right now they're being criticized by a lot of segments of society, and I feel that these kids are our leaders, they're our future, and I think that a lot of us in this room, we're not going to be around,
right.
But they are, so, but since that's already been addressed, I'm just going to ask you, the tax budget bill or whatever, the Reform Act, Tax Cut Act, there's an estimate of a $1.4 to $1.7 trillion deficit.
I
pledge not to use Medicare and Social Security money to help to make up for that deficit.
We are not going to use Social Security to make up for that. Social Security is kind of kept in a separate fund. I don't think the traditional Medicare spending is going to be used to make up for it either, except for the fact that I do think, rightfully or wrongfully, people may eventually look at the very wealthy and say, and I'm saying down the road, say maybe they can afford to pay more of their Medicare premium. But I think for the average person, I do not see that something's going to happen in the near future.
Because just our premiums, even with Medicare, supplements that we pay and dental insurance and others, and a little bit of out-of-pocket for dental and eyeglasses, even qualify us for some tax credit. And we are a middle-class family, so that's how high our premiums are.
Right.
You know, to qualify us. So.
Right. You understand.
And that it's very important for us to have Medicare, or it would be nominally worse. We would lose everything.
Right. The goal of the tax cuts is to grow the economy, okay? And if you're going to look down the road at balancing the budget, you're really not going to balance the budget if we're puttering along with like 2.5% increase in economic growth. You want to get back to the days in which there are 4 or 5% increases. And you're not going to get those increases if your tax structure is not competitive with the rest of the industrialized world. So the primary goal of the tax cuts, well, it's nice to have people hold more of their own money. The primary goal is to grow the economy. As you grow the economy, you get in more corporate income tax receipts, personal income tax receipts, and quite frankly, more Social Security and Medicare tax receipts.
Lisa Johnston.
My question was related to banning of bump stocks and trying to have a smaller cliff.
Okay. I think,
and that's common sense. That's
right.
Reasonable. I hear gun owners talk about it all the time.
I think bump stocks will probably be bad.
And what about a reduction in clips?
That I don't know.
Why?
Correct. I'm sorry.
Well, I'm not sure the bill like that will get to the floor. We will see. I think there's a borderline consensus to move to something bump stocks.
Brad Boston? Baston?
Yes, I've got a couple questions. One is, don't you think it's a little ridiculous in shootings that we can sit there after, I don't know when it started, if it was before or after 9/11, the government can afford for the armed guard or person to sit in a Social Security office 8 hours a day, but we can't do anything for the schools?
Well,
yes or no? Just.
That
you think it's a little ridiculous?
It is ridiculous.
Okay. Now, you talked about overcrowding in the jails or whatever. We've been having this trouble for a long time in the prisons and that. We have all these repeat offenders. You've seen the man who walked paper. There's kids in there or people that are in there 3, 4, 5 times in a row in one knife in the paper for different offenses than that. And they're in there all the time. Here, you want to solve the problem? Give those people an ultimatum. You can go and serve in the armed forces for 4 years or go and sit in prison for 10 years.
No.
Instead of all this monkey business all the time.
I think the time, and rightly or wrong, that there was a time when I was a child, where the judge would kind of tell people to go to the armed services. Right now, it's much more difficult to get into the armed services. I don't think they want some of those people. I do think that there was a significant drop in the number of murders in this country between like 1980 and 2014 or 2015. And the reason for the significant drop was we began to incarcerate more people. And so more dangerous criminals were on the streets. And I think, as I mentioned in Florida, one of the problems they had down there is they decided to go the exact opposite way with dangerous people. If you don't lock up super dangerous people, a given number that we're going to kill me. I don't think that it would be necessarily predictable. You'd have all these people killed in Florida because Nicholas Cruz was kind of an anomaly. But I think it'd be predictable when you have somebody who they call the police on 30 times and has never charged somebody. I think it's predictable it's going to hurt somebody. So I think that was predictable, and their policy down there was a huge policy.
And then immigration, we have laws on the books. Back from who knows when. Let's enforce those laws instead of worrying about talking about new ones.
I will agree with you. I think there are powerful people in this country who, for a variety of motivations, have not wanted immigration laws enforced. We ought to enforce them. There's no doubt, and it will ruin the country if we don't enforce them. And I do agree with you that when we begin to, we need more immigrants in this country. We take our immigrants, not by people who are appropriately vetted, but whoever sneaks across the border. Of course you're going to get people that are disproportionately enough. I think it's something that happened under both administrations. It was wrong of Barack Obama not trying to enforce immigration laws, and it was wrong of George Bush not to enforce immigration laws, and Bill Clinton as well. Okay, there's something else I haven't addressed. You can remind me if somebody doesn't ask me a question. I'll deal with the tariffs on steel and aluminum. We've got to talk about that. I'll talk about that unless anybody has any questions. But no, I am strongly in favor of enforcing immigration laws, and it is scandalous to be not enforced.
And then I have three more here. One.
Why don't we give someone else a chance? Otherwise, we're going to take us the whole time.
We're going in a pretty rapid book here, so we'll probably get you again. We won't say no more. We see you there, and a lot of people aren't asking questions, so I think we're going to come around and get you again.
Debbie Patel?
I'm once again changing from my question that I signed up to do. I'm curious what you would say to the six district constituents that have no representation now in Madison because Walker has refused to call special elections in the 42nd district.
Well, I know there was a court case on that the other day, and hopefully that will solve that problem.
So you would favor
which one is the 6th district? Which one is that?
It's the 42nd, the open 42nd assembly seat.
Is that
which,
the rip seat?
Yeah, so it folds, part of it is in your district, and so some of your constituents are not represented.
Well, I guess I'll put it this way. I thought Keith Grimm was a tremendous representative. He was one of the nicest guys in Washington, Madison. And as I understand, there was a court that ordered an election soon, and I'll look forward to meeting the new assemblyman from that area.
So you would favor that? Okay. Thank you.
Nick Tefke?
My question is in regard to the Russia investigation. Recently there was a tweet from Four-Star General Perry McCaffrey that said, reluctantly I conclude that President Trump is a serious threat to U.S. national security. He is refusing to protect vital U.S. interests from active Russian attacks. Just wondering your thoughts on the generals.
Well, I think what Donald Trump did as far as evicting Russians here is about the most aggressive thing. We have had against the Russian government in recent memory. So the people who say that Donald Trump is soft-pedaling relationships with Russia, I just don't think that's accurate. I mean, or he wouldn't have done what he did. Was it yesterday or 2 days ago?
So you don't agree with the government?
No, I think Donald Trump has been very aggressive with Russia. And, you know, I would eventually like to find out more about the Russian situation, but there are people who like to always be has gone far enough for the time being.
Connie Hendrys?
Yes. I'm wondering, what is the thinking in Congress about medical marijuana? Wisconsin has an aging population, and there are a number of circumstances that medical marijuana, without the THC that's too high, can resolve problems with glaucoma, people who are undergoing chemo, people with abortion disorder diseases.
Right. I am co-sponsoring a bill.
CBD oil.
CBD, what is it?
CBD oil.
Say, I remember.
CBD oil, not the THC, right.
Right. I am co-sponsoring a bill. So that's a good thing. And there's a guy I'm meeting with regard to medical marijuana. He's kind of looking for medical marijuana for the better. So I'm learning a little bit more about that.
Well, I think the general population could benefit.
Right.
Strongly. Thank you for doing that.
Kelly Dirkman?
Sure. It's been a while before I'm eligible for Medicare. This month got an estimate for COBRA, and to cover my insurance after last month, I was on $670 per month. And that's before I'm even getting any insurance. So my question is, what are you doing to help people like that are still getting insurance through employer? I am going on the exchange for that. I can get for $50 a month. And actually, insurance I prefer compared to what I have with my employer. I'd like to see more options for employees, and not be restricted to what their employer is offering.
Well, over time, we've got to get down the cost of medical care in the country. And I think individual businesses are doing a good job on that, but some of the government has to facilitate helping. Are you employed with somebody else right now?
No, I'm between jobs.
Somehow we've got to lower the overall cost of medical care. And I think large employers are doing a good job of that. But obviously not everybody can work for a company with, say, over 500 employees. The reason, there are a variety of reasons why healthcare costs are so high in this country, but I think the primary reason is you don't have market forces at work. And as people have the ability to shop for their, providers for lower medical costs, as medical providers were not incentivized to, I think, sometimes do more than is necessary, the cost of medical care would fall. And
so, do you think that these larger employers are doing that is lowering the cost? My employer was about 300 people, and $670 was the cost of an individual premium.
Okay, it was just for you?
Yeah, it was a high deductible plan.
So your employer was charging you $680?
No, I was paying $150, but since I'm no longer...
The cost to the employer was $680.
The total cost to me plus my employer. So that...
And that was for a deductible move?
Yeah, it was high deductible on $2,000 before anything gets paid.
What an employer should do, and I don't know what they would do, is over time, employers should go to employee paid, first of all, they should self-insure. Secondly, they should go to employer-based clinics, which for a variety of reasons wind up with a great reduction in cost. Employers, if they are big enough, can even hire people to coach employees as to where you should go for this operation or that operation, which also lowers cost as well. Employers should put in some sort of deductible, so which most employers are doing today, when coupled with an HSA, will also result in an overall reduction of costs. And as more and more employers go that way, I think we should see overall healthcare costs fall and medical providers operate more, trying to reduce costs to get patients. But you can't get a significant reduction if your employer does those things. Hopefully over time, small employers will be able to band together and do the same sort of thing. I know in Manitowoc County here, both the county and I think the county act concert with other governmental entities is great to reduce their costs, or at least done something to get a handle on their costs. I would say great to reduce, look out a handle on it compared to what it was happening before that was done.
Bob Melzer?
Hi, I'm here to ask for encourage you to move House Bill 502, abandoned water conservation fund that it put in a closet somewhere in the house, and it's about to expire on September 30th of this year. This provides funds to man.
There was nothing in the omnibus bill about it.
What
I will do is, we will get your name. Like I said, that omnibus bill is plenty of the other pages. I don't know what's on it, so. But we can have my staff check into it. Make sure you give them their number.
Is this all directed to help to provide support for the Ice Age Trail, which goes through Wisconsin? And it's probably the third most famous national scenic Ice Age Trail in the country.
I know we get more land out there from time to time, and the goal, I think, the long-term goal is to buy up all the land. I've walked on it, it is tremendous. Tremendous gem.
Pardon me?
Tremendous gem.
Yeah. So we need money, this is federal money, state money, and private money that makes it work.
Correct. Bit by bit, chip on it.
Federal money is second to last.
Okay, we will see what's going on.
Thank you.
And Chris actually handles that issue for our office, so he'd be happy to talk about it with you afterwards. Linda Schinman?
Schinman? I have a few comments to make from some things that you talked about, and I'll take 30 seconds. And then I think someone already talked about the question that I had, but I sometimes find out one of the facts that you said support that current welfare system discourages recipients from being gainfully employed. All the research I've read on that says the opposite. I've talked to several small businesses who said that they cannot deduct as much as they did prior to 2018. This new tax bill is hurting small businesses more so than helping. Making schools safer by metal detectors and other such changes makes students feel like they're in a prison, and it's very inconvenient. As a retired teacher, we had metal detectors in the school a couple times because we had bomb threats, and it takes forever just for the kids to get in school. Policy should come out that will reflect that AR-15s and AK-47s are not covered by the Second Amendment because they are medical, military grade weapons. The school to prison pipeline and assaults on black men by police officers should be put on the top shelf for our investigation. If schools are educating students and people for employment, businesses should pay a part of the student's tuition because the state is paying for the training. Some people become drug abusers because of government policies makes life difficult for the middle and working classes, and a lot of government policies slant toward the rich, and people get into drugs simply because they can't handle their life the way it is. Last thing is, research says that crime is not down because of incarceration, and that's been proven. Since the 1990s, the crime has been down, and we have absolutely no question that it has nothing to do with incarceration. And the other question I had is, you said that Russia, that the president is being aggressive with Russia. I would disagree with that too. In what way is he being aggressive? Because he's been ignoring me, he's not done anything.
Well, when we kick these people out of the country, that's a pretty aggressive thing.
Well, that just happened, and that's
right.
Because the rest of the world did it.
Right.
All these, for the whole, how many months has this been on?
I will ask, we also have, to a certain extent, tamped down on trade with Russia and given our economic power. That's a fairly aggressive thing to do. I'll ask you, what else do you want to do with Russia? What do you want to do with this? Troops over there?
That's what your job is. Your job is to find out what are other things to do. You have all these.
So you think we should do more confrontation with Russia?
No, I'm saying you should get, as a body, our Congress should invite all minds, from science and religion and schools, to, hey, let's talk about this and find out what is the best way to handle this?
Well, I mean, our Armed Service Committee, I'm sure there are people there weighing in on what we should do with Russia. I can tell you, overall, we have a lot of enemies in the world right now. And I think we should hesitate a little before we are more aggressive and make a lot of enemies. But I am aware there are a lot of people who want to be a lot more aggressive towards Russia. And I'll take your opinion back.
Can I just ask
but thank you for your passion. Thank you for your passion.
Susan Jennings?
I have a question.
Okay. Sue Vandermeers?
Hi, Glenn. I work for Fuller Credit Union, which serves a number of your constituents, and my comments are more about something that's not necessarily making headline news. I want to thank you for your efforts on common sense regulation. As I informed your staffer in December, in 2017 alone, I reviewed 33 regulatory publications for new laws. So far this year, I've had 12. We're not even to the end of the range. So as a small community financial, this burden is not sustainable and it's been causing mergers and buyouts. This is not only costing financials, it's costing the consumers that we serve, reducing consumer choice as well when these financials are closing. Now, the Senate recently passed S-2155 and that received bipartisan support. My ask for you is to allow credit unions and other community financial institutions to help better meet consumers' needs, that you vote for this bill providing better opportunities for small businesses and mortgages.
You know, I voted for many bills trying to help out the small banks.
I am aware of that, and I want to thank you.
We do what we can, and that bill came over from the Senate. And we wish it could have been broader. I think we're going to have to, I will vote for it as is, because we're a little bit afraid if we amended it all to be more favorable, we'll send it back to the Senate and we'll die there. And it is a testament to how unfairly they have treated credit unions and small banks that they were able to get over 60 votes for that in the Senate, because they really had to stand up to Elizabeth Warren to get it done. But it is an untold story, the degree to which people are not getting mortgages they should have been able to get. And if they get mortgages, they are paying more than they have to. You know, sometimes getting appraisals they shouldn't have to get, where you know what the value of the house is. And the blizzard of regulation in our society, paperwork that so many people have to put up with, kind of lowers the standard of living for everybody. And it's particularly onerous on small banks and credit unions, because everybody should be able to afford a house, and it makes it more difficult to get a house, right?
Absolutely. And the CFPB, thank goodness, has got like that. But the mortgage servicing rule, just one little portion of their oversight since 2013 has been amended 13 times. How
would
we keep up?
Horrible. And whenever I meet with the credit unions and banks, I wish they would take out ads in the paper, explain to people how foolish the unintended consequences of Dodd-Frank was. It was just a foolish law. Yep.
Ann Dirkman? Tom Hall?
Yes. My question would be in reference to the tax bill. And why again did you say this was passed?
I think to improve the economy.
So, and how does this improve the economy?
Because I think it makes our businesses more competitive with businesses abroad.
And it makes us more competitive.
Correct. Not only when big corporations decide where they're going to add factories, where they're going to close factories, but also under the old system, if you made money abroad and brought it back to the United States, you'd be taxed again, so that discourages companies from investing in the United States.
And on a dollar basis, what part of the population reap the most benefit from individual tax cuts.
I suppose the economy grows every bit.
No, my question is, based on dollar value, which part of the population is going to benefit the most from these tax cuts, the individual tax cuts?
I suppose, percentage-wise, I think the average guy,
on a dollar basis, not on a percentage basis, on a dollar basis.
Well, I can tell you the people whose taxes are going up are largely high-income people from high-tax states. I mean, look at the Republicans who voted against the tax, but there weren't many of them. But in the House, they were all people from New Jersey, New York, or California. And they all were hearing from their high-income individuals. And because we capped out the mortgage interest deduction at mortgages under $750,000, and because we capped the deduction on state and local taxes, that primarily affected people who pay a lot of state and local taxes, which is the wealthy. And the few people in our society who own houses worth more than $750,000, which is again the wealthy. So the people whose taxes are going up are the wealthy. I can tell you, as we went through the iterations of the bill, the few people who contacted me and worked through their taxes and told me they were getting a tax increase were, again, the wealthy, pretty wealthy people who didn't own a business. You know, I got a call from somebody who I believe was a head of a major corporation, I'm sure made over $1 million a year. He was mad because his taxes were going up, and assuming he calculated, I would think that would be the type of person on the list. The rare person whose taxes went up would be that type of person. If you didn't own your own business, but were highly compensated people. So I would think those are the people who, if you'd say, Glenn, is anybody's taxes going up under the tax bill? I would say largely would be high income people who don't own their own business.
So someone who makes $1 million.
Right.
Well, let's pretend their tax rate went down 2.6%. Okay, so that's...
Well, what happened to their deduction?
What? Sure. So on $1 million, that would be $26,000. On $10 million, that would be $260,000 that they would be saving. Okay? And I don't know what their mortgage rate was or how much they're paying in mortgage,
right?
But I don't think it's worth $260,000. It is estimated by the Americans for the Tax Fairness Group. They estimated that Charles and David Koch Industries could probably save $1 to $1.5 billion in taxes every year. Why couldn't you, to be fair to everybody, give everybody a $2,000 tax credit? That would have been fair. Give everybody $2,000 tax credit.
Well, their tax credits for dependents on the bill.
I'm
and
sorry.
Like I said, I think that those credits are regardless of income. So in that regard, there were tax credits, at least for people with dependents. And like I said, I can tell you, common sense will tell you this. Wealthy people pay more in state and local income tax. When we capped that deduction, therefore, it primarily hurt very wealthy people. Okay? I can tell you on a personal level, when people calculate their taxes next year, the few people who contact me and think their taxes are going up are usually very high income people. And I can tell you when I talk to my colleagues in Congress who voted against the tax bill, they voted against the tax bill because they felt high income people in states like New York, New Jersey, and California were getting tax increases. So that's whose taxes were going up. Now,
and what did President Trump say down in Key Largo, wherever he was, when he was talking to his friends? You all just got a lot richer.
I think some people, particularly in the corporate world, if you owned, well, look at the stock market. I think the stock market dropped today, but if you look over the last 14 months or 16 months, the stock market went up to a certain extent in anticipation of the change in the tax law. They thought it would improve the economy. That's a good thing. If your 401k went up, that's a good thing.
Correct. If you have a 401k.
That's right.
How many people do not have a 401k?
I don't know right off the top of my head what percentage of people
have.
The other but we want to grow the economy.
One other issue that I would like to just bring up quickly. Social Security. We know that it has issues, but once you start earning over $118,000, you no longer pay the Social Security tax.
Right.
Correct. These are the people who can most afford to pay the Social Security tax. If somebody has income and all of their income is on capital gains, they're going to pay 15%.
Right.
Anybody who makes a regular salary is paying 10-12% plus Social Security tax, which is 7%.
Correct.
So they're paying a higher rate of tax than people who are just making money on capital gains, which would be the ultra low.
And I have made that point to a degree as we're putting our tax bill together. I want you to be aware, Social Security right now is a very progressively designed program, right? I mean, if you make $80,000 a year your whole life, your benefit is not twice that of the person making $40,000 a year, right? You're familiar with the system. It disproportionately benefits the person with the lower income. So right now, Social Security is a very progressive program.
Jack Lawler? Lawler?
I pass.
Okay. Paul Planker?
Clinker. Thank you for being here tonight.
Sure.
Regarding gun violence, it's my wish that the NRA would grab the bull by the horns and take the lead on solving this issue. I would think that would be a great PR deal for them. Rhetorically, is there any chance of them doing that? But do you or your cohorts have any influence with the NRA to suggest that and push that?
Well, first of all, I want to talk about the NRA. There was a time, it's not true anymore, but there was a time where Sheboygan County had either the largest or second largest annual banquet, NRA banquet in the country. Okay, just something. The strength of the NRA is not because they give relatively, compared to other interests, relatively small campaign contributions, but they hire a bunch of people. I don't know where the NRA is based. Let's say they hire a bunch of people in Washington. The strength of the NRA is the huge number of gun owners in this country who are members of the NRA. And there has been effort made since I was a child to try to ban guns. Actually, when I was a child, I was thinking about this. When I was a child, the effort was made to ban handguns. Because people would say, why do you need a handgun except for shooting people? We ought to allow rifles to be legal and not handguns. Now, after some highly publicized shootings, they kind of go the other way. They kind of imply we ought to take rifles and leave handguns. But in our Constitution, we have a Second Amendment. You could read why our forefathers wanted a Second Amendment in there. I think the goal of the NRA is to protect the rights of the Second Amendment, because there are a lot of people who I think, quite frankly, wish it didn't exist. We had a significant decrease in the number of homicides in this country between 1980 and I think it was 2015. So things are moving in the right direction. For the last couple of years, for whatever reason, we've been going in reverse. But like I said, we're passing some laws in Congress. I think a combination of some mental health treatment, some improving of the background checks, and some maybe getting away from this new wave of not putting criminals in prison. I think hopefully we'll get back to these decreases again. But the strength of the NRA has nothing to do with an organization called NRA, nothing to do with relatively small campaign contributions compared to the price of these campaigns. The strength of the NRA is the huge number of members who see people who, quite frankly, would like to take all their guns. That's where the strength of the NRA comes from.
Frank Sturzel? Frank?
First of all, Congressman, thank you for voting no on the 1.3 trillion.
Thank you.
I tried to wrap my head around $1 trillion. Discovered that $1 trillion is a $100 bill stacked 5 feet high on half the square mile.
Right.
Which ain't telling you. Seems to be a real reluctance on the part of Congress to deal with individual issues like defense spending. I don't know. What strategy do you see in the next 6 months to try to reverse this business as usual, kick the can down the road, spending? I'm afraid for my children and my grandchildren.
The problem, if you're in my shoes, is that the vast majority of people who contact me in an individual budget want to spend more money. And human nature being what human nature is, we like to make the people around us happy. And therefore, the average, and Calvin Coolidge said, there are few things more enjoyable than spending other people's money. The combination of those things has resulted in this ominous bogus and disappointment. But obviously a lot of politicians are having a lot of fun spending other people's money. I can tell you Donald Trump said he signed this bill reluctantly, and hopefully because he signed the bill reluctantly, he will take an aggressive lead in the new budget that he proposes to try to rein in some of the spending. As I mentioned, I do not think the Senate, sadly, is going to even allow us to pass reductions in mandatory spending with their 51 votes this year. But I hope Donald Trump tries to whip them into shape. I have talked to individual senators, and maybe we can make a dent on some of those programs this time around. If they don't make a dent this time around, I think we'll be, should be the number one goal for Congress after the first of the year. But the underlying problem is that if you stand in my shoes, it amazes me the number of people who contact me. And despite the fact that we have this $21 trillion in debt, they come to me and say, I have a neat idea on how to spend our money. I love the people here. The meeting I had before I was here in one of the rooms of the tech school here, and I love Lakeshore Tech. They do a great job. You know, they just want to make sure that I'm supporting a program that people use here, make sure tax. That's a typical meeting in my life, meeting with people who want more taxpayer money. And one way to look at it is right now we're $60,000. I think it's over $60,000 in debt for every man with a child. So if you think of that, you got a family of four, in addition to whatever mortgage they have in their house, you have a $240,000 mortgage here. And that's not as the actuarial unit. That's real debt. Before you worry about an accrued debt like Social Security and Medicare that has not literally been issued yet, but we know it's hanging up there. So I don't know if it's the biggest threat of the country. I think the biggest threat is some moral breakdown, but the government debt has got to be right up there. And right now that Congress, which was supposed to be such a conservative Congress that we elected 2 Novembers ago, is not made up of people who are primarily the debt.
A portion of our debt is held in China.
I'm not sure what the percentage is, but it is, yeah.
John Wyden.
Congressman Ron DeSantis, your colleague, has introduced a bill which he calls the Swamp Act. I haven't had a chance to read it. I just heard about it the other night. So I urge you to have a chance to read it, and he's looking for co-sponsors.
Ron's a buddy of mine. I might already be co-sponsoring, am I? I signed that on one of his bills last week. I don't know if that was one of them.
He calls it Drain the Swamp Act, right?
I'll look at it. Ron's a good guy. He's running for the Senate.
Running for governor.
He's running for governor. He's running for something. I like Ron. He's a sharp guy, and I wish him.
He's a good guy.
He is a great guy. We'll look at the bill for him.
That was our last question.
They go with the guy in the red. I told Rob the guy in the red and come back to him, so we're going to go with the guy in the red.
Okay, three more things. One, I urge you to go back to Washington and introduce a bill that when you guys shut the government down, you don't get paid.
not fair that other people in the government not get paid, but you guys keep getting paid. I don't think that's fair.
Right, and when we shut down for a couple of weeks, what, that I sent my check to the Salvation Army, a couple of Salvation Army, so I made sure I didn't keep the money for the whatever.
It should be that no matter who you or any of them,
right,
you don't get paid, and you don't get reimbursed after the government opens up again. You lose all your benefits again. You don't work, you don't get paid. That's how I did. I went
right
for 39 years. If I didn't show up to work, I didn't get paid. I went right 39 years and I never got holiday pay, vacation pay, sick pay, or anything in our industry. And
right. Well, when we shut down, I'll keep sending my checks to social to a Salvation Army, and when you shut down, at least I'm not relatively new on the job, but I think we're always in there, we're always in Washington working as long as the shutdown happens until they sell the shutdown.
And two more things. One, I think everybody in this room can agree, we're sick of hearing about the Russian gold. And if it was any of us, we would have been sitting in jail already, and Hillary and everybody burning out. I think everybody's sick of hearing that on the news, and I think it's just hurting the Democrats and the Republicans every day it's on the news. Because when it comes time to vote, I don't know if I'm going to vote for either the Democrat or the Republican. And then, you know what the shared problem is, right?
Right, I assume I'm sure it's got a lot of those.
I know that you do. You've gotten letters.
Right.
Everybody's gotten letters. If you had a vote on that today, right now, yes or no?
Well, we've got to find the money. I can tell you I would have been in favor of doing something on that issue, and I wish when they had spent this money in the omnibus, they would have spent a little less money on those programs and began to fund the pension problem. Ron Johnson was 100% right when he came out and said, if we had set a target for government spending that would include an increase in discretionary spending of 10%, we should have spent less on the current programs and more funding that plan, because we know sooner or later we're going to have to put money in that plan. It might not be 100% reimbursement, but as you know, I'm doing what I can to help people in that situation. There was a committee set up. My guess is they're not going to vote on anything until after the election. Oh, what he's talking about is
your pension.
There are a variety of pension plans, but it primarily affects the Teamsters in this area, in which there's not enough money in the fund to pay the pension that they've been promised. And ultimately what will have to happen, because they're not only is it unfair to the pensioners about that are going to get their money, but ultimately enough businesses are on the hook for that liability that there's going to have to be a deal reached in which the pensioners, the employers, and the government all kick in something towards solving that problem.
But that has to be voted on or settled by November 30th of this year with the committee now. They've come up with a plan that everybody, a lot of you people out there, has agreed with, and some of you people are sitting on the fence yet, that you won't move unless somebody that's been here longer than you have says, okay, we're going to go this route or we're not. And then everybody jumps on it. Gallagher is one of them. And he's not making a move until somebody that has more time out there and that says, we're going to go along with it or not. And you know that the government is the one that screwed this pension plan up back in the 70s, and they said they were going to watch it, and they didn't.
Well,
you can go and give us an answer one way or the other how you stand on this bill. Baldwin and everybody else has all said that we're backing you people, but you haven't said one word about backing.
Well, you know I publicly was in favor of Ron Johnson's stance of doing something with all this money that was appropriated towards the pension. They didn't. Right? They spent all the money on current programs or increased current programs, knowing full well that eventually the taxpayer was going to pay for something. Okay, thanks for all being here.